What's up, guys? Y'all, please let me know if you can hear me good. I have an important message straight off the 8% Nation presses. We, learned a lot while we were up there, but got a lot of questions asked, and I just have something to share with you that I think will help you, and it'll help alleviate some of the frustration I have with this common question that skips all the right answers in between the right question and the right answer. So I don't know if you can read the caption on this. Not sure if it came out right, but I wanted to, I've made it, the one question that pisses me off, and I'm not trying to be, vulgar or shocking, just trying to get your attention a little bit before I go over something that I was asked a lot. So I'm about to get really real with you for a minute. And this is, I think it's very important. I think a lot of you probably already understand this, but there are a lot of you that don't. So basically, I want everybody here in the long run to know me for one thing. I'm not always going to be I'm not going to say I'm the best motivational speaker. I'm not going to say that I'm the best, at running a Facebook group. I'm not going to say that I'm the best at, branding or marketing or whatever, but everybody will know me for being extremely real with you. I want to be the realest person coming from a position of success, sharing what I know about the industry. I want to be the most realistic person. So while I was at 8%, I was asked probably 96 times this question by people who seem to be brand new to the industry, brand new. And it just really, really got under my skin trying to answer this when I felt like the only way to answer this was to skip the question altogether. So it was some variation of a question kind of like this. What is the fastest way to $1 million? What's the fastest way to $100,000 a year in this business? What one thing can I do to get here? What's the best lead source to get me here? What's the best this or that? What do I need to do? What little one thing do I need to do? What little two things do I need to do? And in my opinion, you shouldn't ask what's the best thing until you're already successful. Because right now, it's not about weeding out the tiny little one thing you can do. It's not about this one tweak or this one lead source or this, one funnel or, all these punchlines that people come up with, these little keywords that people are coming up with to try to get you thinking, oh, if I can just do this, or like everybody has some sort of secret, they're keeping from you. And because you don't know the secret, you're not able to get where they are. If only you knew this one secret, if only you knew. I saw earlier, even in the group, I see them post, and like I said, no question is ever a dumb question. It's always smart. And when somebody's coming from a position of, hey, I'm doing this, 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 and this, what's the best? I understand it gets to a point where we start to want to refine things to be more effective and better. But when you're not effective at all, you have to know one thing. And the one thing you have to know, the one thing, is that it all works. They all work. Direct mail, cold calling, telemarketers from wherever, Facebook leads, buying leads from Facebook, creating them yourself, YouTube leads, Google paid advertising, going out and knocking on businesses' doors, making friends with P&C agents, making friends with with agents that don't do what you do, partnering with them, joining a B&I group. All of these things work. My first year, I was the vice president of a B&I group. It was actually an inception B&I group. I helped take it off the ground and grow it into a successful B&I group. I helped, I met every freaking P&C agent in town, and on my minute non-existent income, on credit cards a lot of times. I was buying PNC agents lunch, telling them how I could help them. Every client that I found at first, I was referring them to PNC agents. I was telling them, hey, what are you doing for your home and auto? Because I understood that principle of giver's gain, which I did learn from B&I, even though I'm not a big B&I guy. You're not ever going to hear me be a cheerleader for B&I, but it's something. It's everything is something in the beginning. And what can you afford? All these things are really, really cheap and inexpensive. In the beginning, you have time. If you don't have time, you're lying to your damn self. You do have time. I mean, now I don't have a lot of time, but I used to have a lot of time. I didn't have money. I didn't have a lot of money. I had a lot of time. And you can put that time in everything. I mean, you can join the CDF. We call it CDF. You can call it the Chamber of Commerce. Join the Chamber of Commerce and start becoming these, you know, ambassador programs. Most cities and areas have a young professionals club or, you know, all these different things, Rotarians, you know, Civitans, different. Those are all free. You can do that. You can make friends with financial advisors. You can do that. You can get on the damn phone and just start calling people. And everybody now that thinks that, like, it's either got to be this national blitzkrieg, lightning war, you know, marketing scheme where local marketing is dumb, or you have to be fully local. That's ridiculous. I mean, I've sold in Virginia, West Virginia, North Carolina, South Carolina, Tennessee, Texas, Alabama, Florida now, Georgia. Sold one in Washington State. You know, I've sold several all over the place, but I also market very heavily right here at home. And in the beginning, you got to do that. You know, you got to do a little bit of do it both. You know, everything works. Everything. There's not something that doesn't work. If you try direct mail and you're not liking it, well, you're not going to like Facebook leads either. I see people all the time message me, hey, I bought leads from so-and-so. I bought Cody's leads and, you know, oh, you know, I don't know if they're working. Same people turn around and tell me they bought leads from another place. It's not the leads. All a lead is somebody on the other end of the conversation, whether in front of you, whether over the phone, who had at some point some slight interest. You know, are they a lay down lead? Are they ready to go? Or are they somebody who you're going to have to talk into it? You're going to have to call them. You have this 12 to 17 contact rule out there. Most very successful call centers have an algorithm built into them where they're calling this number back at least five times very quickly. You're talking about you call, no answer, call right back. You wait 2 hours, call back again, or wait 30 minutes, call back again, wait 2 hours, call back again. Then you're calling back the next day at a different time. And they have all this done in computers, but guess what? You also don't need computers. I mean, you know, my dad, who didn't have the agency to where it is now, but he started out taking a phone book and a phone like this kind of phone and dialing one number at a time. Now you can't do that because of the damn Patriot Act or whatever, but you can still get scrub data, call one at a time. You can do Facebook leads, export them in an Excel spreadsheet and call your Excel spreadsheet. Highlight the ones that you'll never write them anything, red. Highlight the ones that you've written, green. Flag them for follow-up for something else. Try to refer them to someone who you think might can refer you something. Highlight the ones that need follow-up, yellow. Put notes out. How many times? I mean, back in the day, people were doing it on a legal pad. I mean, now, you know, you can get all these computer programs, but you don't need them. You don't need, you know, all these different things that people think they need. Shit, if you can't afford an e-fax line, go to the library. I mean, everything works, man. Everything works. And I don't know why everybody seemed to think that I know something that nobody else knows. What I know is I did this much to get to this level so that I could take all I have and reinvest it back into growing to this level. Let's see. Yes, I'm saying you have to work to get sales. That's exactly what I'm saying. You have to work, man. Everybody in here has to work the same. Nobody in here is handed people coming to you and trusting you with the things that they, with their money. I mean, whether you're selling something for a premium or whether you're selling something for, you know, it's all for a premium. Even in Medicare Advantage, even if it's a zero premium, you still have people's trust with that. You're transforming their Medicare coverage completely, you know, and you're not going to get that easily. But every bit of it, the part that works, and it sucks in the beginning and you're not making much. I was like really, really out running down direct mail leads. This is one of the greatest things that I did in my second year. I was probably only in it 9 months when I decided that I was going to replicate the lead vendors that I'd seen try to sell me direct mail, direct response mail. I was going to replicate the mailer. I replicated the mailer in my own way, changed it a little bit, tweak it, went to the post office, talked to them, figured out how to set up a business reply mail card, talked to a printing service, got as many of them printed as I could, and dropped with the business reply mail account. What that means is I was cutting out the middleman, the lead vendor. You know, there was no profit being made on it. What did that mean for me? I mean, when I swiped my credit card and spent thousands of dollars on it, if the leads didn't come in, I was screwed. But if you're not willing to make that investment a little bit, it really isn't going to work out for you. I mean, if you're looking for an FMO that gives you free leads all day and all this crap, there's no free leads out there that are just like, you know, free policies. Because if there were, then the person that is giving them to you would not be giving them to you. They just write it. It's like when you see somebody selling a course on how to do something and you think, but if what they are telling me how to do works so well, why would they be doing that instead of just out there doing it? You know, which is a little silly because sometimes you can create a course and replicate your sales process while you sleep. But if you were selling a course that took up my time, if you were going to pay me to sit down with you for all these hours, but what I'm teaching you how to do is so valuable, I would just be doing that and replicating it more. So, you know, anyway, and all of you have these thoughts. When you see Ty Lopez, for instance, and this isn't to knock on Ty Lopez, but you have these second guesses about what he's really teaching you, you know. And it's the same thing with the lead, with the, you know, FMO or MO or lead vendor or whatever that's giving you these leads or selling you leads. There's nothing special about them that you can't cultivate them yourself. And there's nothing special there. And until you learn how, I think it's a great place to do it. Buy leads, you know, but there's really no, I mean, it's, you know, I know I ramble. You also know me for being real and rambling. I did it on stage at the Q&A panel. I kept telling everybody I'm gonna ramble on a little bit. My theme song is going to be Led Zeppelin Ramble On. Or Allman Brothers Ramblin' Man. But anyway, I'll just take it back to the core of what I'm saying. And what I am trying to get across to you is that everything works. What you're doing right now probably works. You just have to keep doing it. Right now, you don't have the biggest renewal chain from it. You don't have all the referrals coming from it. You don't have a hierarchy that sells while you're not selling, so you can commit, you can be, you know, taking a little bit. All these things that can come over time as you build, you know. And then that kind of brings up another point. What the hell is the deal with all the 20-year-olds coming in the business and starting recruiting with no residual chain and no money in the bank? What do you think happens when you recruit some guy and he goes and writes 17 final expense policies? And then goes and takes another contract somewhere else and rolls them over and leaves you with a huge debt balance to pay out. I mean, you don't have any money and you're recruiting. You can't recruit with no money. Don't recruit with no money. We didn't hardly recruit at all until recently. And it's not a main focus, but you know, now we have a $2.2 million annual renewal chain, you know, with a lot of expenses coming out of it. But if I have a debit balance, hell, I can afford it. If you're 20 years old, you can't afford that crap unless you're inherited a bunch of money from your perv uncle or something. But anyway, again, getting off topic, take it back. Everything works. Go work. Go do it. Do all the hard stuff. The first 2 years should suck, because if they don't really suck, then the third year is going to continue to kind of suck like those first two ones. Make them suck really hard. Spend all your money on leads. Spend all your money on gas or whatever your mechanism is. If it's gas or if it's phone lines, if it's any of that, keep on doing that. And by the time you're in your third year, you'll have such a renewal. And I think that's the reason, like, life only agents, and I'm not hating on life only agents, but I'm telling you, throw a little Medicare in there so you can build a little residual, something, health, whatever. Because when I see, you know, a life only agent making 100 grand the first year that they're in the business, but then a third year in, they're still making 100 grand. You know, the burnout's going to come for them at some point. I mean, maybe not all of them. Maybe some of you are wired like Grant Cardone and burnout doesn't exist. But I tell you, the best thing for burnout is residual income. Because come January of each year, I'm kind of burnt out and I like to take it easy, and I can't. And I went a whole bunch of trips. And so my conferences come up in, you know, April, May, June, July, August. You know what I do? I go to them. I take my kids to the beach at spring break, and I go on another beach trip for Columbus Day, and I go on a beach trip for Labor Day, because I have residual income, a big one. So, you know, and at some point now, if you're in a life business, if you just wanted to do life only, you know, I know there's some of you in here, you can, but you're going to have to build a business. You're going to have to train other people to work for you so you can take time off. And that's the way to do that. And it is possible. You know, I know it is, you know, but in Medicare, I just love the residual business. I like, now that I have the residual, now I might set up a life shop where I'm running agents for life. You know, I think that's comes second for me. No, I don't go to Biloxi Beach. That's a nasty place. And y'all ought to stay away from there. Biloxi sucks. You go straight over to 38 down by Seaside. That's where Coach Michael Burt's vacation house is. Seaside, Alice Beach. That's another tangent. Biloxi is nasty. The beach looks like the sands of Iwo Jima. You know, I don't want to think about dead Japanese people when I'm at the beach. So that's why I don't go there. Anyway, it's late. I was not going to do this tonight. I was going to put it off, but it's been irking at me to get on here and just say this stuff. And if some of you think I'm stupid and don't know what I'm talking about, that's fine, because I don't really, you know, I get fed off of that. Y'all hate on me, share it around and make fun of me. And you'll go to Turks. I'll go to Turks with you. Now, Turks is where it's at. So I'll see you guys later. Love you all. So proud to have you guys with me as the entourage when we were going to 8% and everybody's watching and cheering everything on. And as we roll through AEP, writing policies. You know, I came back today after that Friday off and wrote about 20 more policies today. You know, didn't do any drug plans, thank God. You know, my Will across the hall from me wrote a bunch. It's just been a good time. So I'll see you guys later.